Hello friends, welcome to Science in Simple Steps. Today we are going to start second chapter of class 9th, which is matter around us pure? So how do we judge whether milk, ghee, butter or anything else which we buy from the market is pure? So have you ever noticed that word pure is written on these packets? For common person, pure means having no adulteration. But for scientists, these things are actually a mixture of different substances. Hence, these are not pure. For example, milk is commonly a mixture of water, fat and protein. So, that milk is not pure. When a scientist says that something is pure, it means that all the constituent particles of the substances are same in their chemical nature. Pure substance consists of single type of particles. In other words, we can say that substance is a pure single form of matter. So now let's study the mixture. Mixture contain more than one substances, and these substances can be element or compounds, and these substances are mixed in any proportion. So we can say a mixture contain more than one substances mixed in any proportion. Mixture can be separated into pure substances using appropriate separation technique. There are different techniques which are used for different mixture types. Types of mixture are, depending upon the nature of component that form a mixture, we have different type of mixtures. First is substance. Substance is a pure single form of matter. It cannot be separated into other kind of matter by any physical process. For example, sugar and sodium chloride. We know that sugar is substance which contain only one kind of pure matter and its composition is same throughout. Soft drink, soil, are the single pure substances. Whatever the sources of substance may be, it will always have the same characteristics properties. Therefore, we can say that mixture contain more than one pure substances. Now, we will discuss the differences among homogeneous mixture and heterogeneous mixture. Homogeneous mixture are those which have uniform composition throughout the mixture. Like if we will add salt in the water, then it will make homogeneous mixture. It means that its composition is same throughout the mixture. The components cannot be separated by filtration method but can take place by distillation method only. In case of heterogeneous mixture, they don't have a uniform composition throughout the mixture. The component can be separated by filtration method. Examples of heterogeneous mixture are sulfur powder and iron fillings, kerosene oil and water. These are the few examples. Now we will discuss about the solution. What is a solution? Now, what is solution? Solution, as the name suggests, is a homogeneous mixture of two or more substances. You can come across various types of solution in your daily life, like lemonade, soda water, etc. These are the examples of solution. Usually we think that solution as a liquid that contain either a solid, liquid or a gas dissolved in it. But we can also have solid solutions, that is called alloys, and gaseous solutions like air. These are also a form of solution. In a solution, there is a homogeneity at a particular level. For example, lemonade tastes the same throughout. This shows that particles of the sugar or salt are evenly distributed in that solution. So we can say that solution is a homogeneous mixture. Now, few more important points about solution are solvent and solute. So what is solvent here? Solvent is the major component of a solution and solute is the minor component of a solution. So concentration of a solution is the amount of solute present per unit volume or per unit mass of the solution. That is called concentration. We can also have solid solution and gaseous solution, as I told you earlier in this slide. So solute solutions are also known as alloys and gaseous solutions are also known as air. Now we will discuss about the properties of a solution. Properties, as we know that always solution is a homogeneous mixture. Now we will discuss about the particle size of a solution. Particle size are smaller than 1 nanometer in diameter, so they cannot be seen by naked eyes. Because of very small particle size, they do not scatter the beam of light. As we know that particle size is less than 1 nanometer, so it don't have that capability that it can scatter the beam of light. If we pass a beam of light through a solution, then it will not scatter that light. So the path of the light is not visible in a solution. The solute particle cannot be separated from mixture by the process of filtration. Solute particles do not settle down when left undisturbed. That is, solution is stable. Only very few things which you have to keep in mind, that is homogeneous mixture. Solution is always have a particle size smaller than 1 nanometer. It cannot scatter the beam of light. And next is cannot be separated from the mixture by filtration process. Now we will discuss about the alloys. Alloys are mixture of two or more metals, or we can say that a metal and non-metal, and these cannot be separated by physical method. But still, alloy is considered as a mixture because it shows the properties of its constituent and can have variable composition. For example, brass is an alloy and it is approximately mixture of 30% zinc and 70% copper. So it is very important to keep in mind that brass is an alloy and its composition is zinc and copper. Now, concentration of solution. Concentration of solution is the amount of solute present in a given amount of solution. That is called concentration of solution. When two or more solutes can be dissolved in a solution at a given temperature, that is called saturated solution. We can add one solute or we can add more than one solute at a given temperature. So amount of solute present in a saturated solution at this temperature is called its solubility. If the amount of a solute contained in a solution is less than the saturation level, then it is called unsaturated solution. Now we know that what is saturated solution, what is solubility, and what is unsaturated solution. Now it is very important to know the different ways of expressing the concentration of a solution. But here we will learn only three methods: mass by mass percentage of solution, mass by volume percentage of solution, volume by volume percentage of solution. Mass by mass is equal to mass of solute or mass of solution multiplied by 100. Mass by volume is mass of solute, volume of solution into 100. Volume by volume is volume of solute and volume of solution multiplied by 100. These are the formula which are very important from exam point of view. There is one question given in the book where you have to calculate the concentration in terms of mass by mass percentage. So answer is also given in the book. Try to solve this question. Now we will discuss the suspension. Material that are insoluble in a solvent and have particles that are visible to naked eyes form a suspension. Suspension is always heterogeneous mixture. As you know that suspension is a heterogeneous mixture, so the particle size of suspension can be seen by naked eyes. The particle of suspension scatter a beam of light. As we know that suspension is a heterogeneous mixture and its particle can be seen, so when these suspensions are left undisturbed, these particles will settle down. So suspension is unstable mixture. They can be separated from the mixture by process of filtration. When the particles settle down, the suspension breaks and it does not scatter any light. So in case of suspension, you have to remember three points which are heterogeneous. It can scatter beam of light as the particle size is large. And it can settle down when left undisturbed, so it is unstable. Now we will study colloidal solution. Colloids are heterogeneous mixture in which particle size is too small, cannot be seen naked eyes, but these are enough big to scatter the light. So scattering of beam of light is called Tyndall effect, after the name of the scientist who discovered this effect. It is called Tyndall effect. Colloids are useful in industry and daily life. Particles are called the dispersed phase and the medium in which they are distributed is called dispersion medium. Let us try to understand the Tyndall effect. Tyndall effect can be observed when sunlight passes through the canopy of the dense forest. In the forest, mist contains tiny droplets of water which act as the particles of colloid dispersed in the air. So we can conclude that colloid is a heterogeneous mixture and particle cannot be seen with the naked eyes, even they can scatter the beam of light. And next one is when left undisturbed, they do not settle down, so colloids are quite stable. So now we will discuss properties of colloids in detail. Colloid is a heterogeneous mixture. Size of the particle of the colloid is too small to be individually seen by the naked eyes. Colloids are being enough to scatter a beam of light passing through it and it make its path visible. They do not settle down when left undisturbed, that is, a colloid is quite stable. They cannot be separated from the mixture by filtration, but a special technique of separation known as centrifugation can be used to separate the colloidal particles. Now we will differentiate among the sol, solution and suspension. Sol is a kind of colloidal solution. As we studied in the last slides, that it has a dispersed phase and dispersion phase. Solution has a soluble solute and solvent phase. Suspension has insoluble solute suspended in solvent medium. So first of all, discuss about the colloidal solution. It appears homogeneous, but it is heterogeneous. This was the main and very important point, that particles are visible with the help of electron microscope. Particle size is 10 to the power minus 7 to 10 to the power minus 5 centimeter. Example, gold solution, milk of magnesia. True solution is homogeneous mixture. Particles are not visible by all means. Particle size is less than 10 to the power minus 7 centimeter. Example is sugar solution, salt solution. Suspension has insoluble solute suspended in solvent medium. It is heterogeneous. Particles are visible by naked eyes. Particle size is more than 10 to the power 5 centimeter. Example is dust storm. So these were the basic differences among sol, solution and suspension. So the basic differences you have to keep in mind is particle size, visibility, stability and the kind of homogeneous or heterogeneous mixture, what kind of it is. So these point you have to remember, and one or two example are enough for the difference. I also covered the question given in between the chapter. So this is the question which was given, and you have to find out its concentration at a given temperature. Solution is also given here. If you have any problem, then write in the comment box. We will discuss it later in the next video. This is also very important slide which was given in your notebook. So I added here in this presentation. So common example of colloids. So first we have to remember that what were the common properties, important characteristics of the colloid. After that we can remember these dispersed phase and medium types, and then their types and examples. It is very interesting, you will enjoy it, I think. So next slide is, what do you observe on churning the milk? On churning the milk, only the separation of components of milk take place by physical phenomenon, that is centrifugation. While churning of milk, cream to get butter, no new substance is formed, that is why it is also known as a physical change. Now explain how the separation of cream from milk takes place. Centrifugation is a method of separating the suspended particles of a substance from a liquid in which it is mixed, and that is rotated at a high speed in a centrifuge machine. Due to this process, milk separates into cream and skimmed milk. And what is that skimmed milk? When all the fat is removed from the milk, then the remaining milk is skimmed milk. It I think it contains around 0.1% of the fat. So here we learn that all those methods where no new substances are formed, that is physical method. So centrifugation is a physical method. So centrifugation is rotation at a high speed in a centrifuge machine. Now we will discuss about the applications of centrifugation. It is used in diagnostic laboratories for blood and urine tests, used in dairies and home to separate butter from cream, used in washing machine to squeeze out water from the wet clothes. And the important point here is the principle of centrifugation. So principle is that the denser particles are forced to the bottom and the lighter particles stay at the top when spun rapidly, spun at a high speed. So this was the principle, and it is very important. Now how can we separate a mixture of salt and camphor? Before discussing this slide, we must know one thing about the camphor, that it directly changes from solid to the gaseous stage on heating, or without heating also it can change directly from solid to the gases. So to separate such mixtures that contain a sublimable volatile component from a non-sublimable impure impurities, the sublimation process is used. Here we have to separate a mixture of salt and camphor. If we want salt, then we will dissolve both the substances in the water. Salt will dissolve and it will leave behind the camphor. Salt can be separated from water by evaporation or by boiling. If you don't need the camphor, let it evaporate by sublimation, leaving behind the salt. So this was about separation of the mixture of salt and camphor. In this picture first shows that separation of ammonium chloride by the sublimation process, and second shows the residue containing sand and common salt dissolved in the water. Next we will discuss how can we separate a mixture of two immiscible liquids. This can be done by simply using a separating funnel. Two liquids are put into a funnel and are left for a short time to settle out and form two layers. The tap of the funnel is opened and the bottom liquid is allowed to run. The two liquids are now separate. In this picture, you can see that how the separation of immiscible liquids takes place. We can separate miscible liquids by method, that is fractional distillation. Separation of two liquids by fractional distillation depend on the differences in their boiling points. Fractional distillation is carried out by using fractional column. And here is the picture which shows how fractional column works. Here you have to remember one thing, that all those liquids which have the difference of boiling point less than 25 Kelvin can be separated by distillation process. For example, gases from the air can be used can be separated by this method. The apparatus is similar to that of the simple distillation, except that a fractionating column is fitted in between the distillation flask and the condenser. So how can we obtain different gases from the air? Air is a homogeneous mixture and can be separated into its component by fractional distillation. As we told earlier in this last slide, the flow diagram shown in the step of the process is as follows. Let's see how we can separate different gases from the air. We have to compress it by increasing pressure and decreasing the temperature. Then we will get liquefied liquid air. Then we have to allow to warm up slowly in fractional distillation column, and gases get separated at different heights because the boiling point of different gases is different. So we can separate different gases. This is the separation of component of the air. Now next is how can we obtain pure copper sulfate from an impure sample. Crystallization is a process that separates a pure solid in the form of its crystal from solution. So crystallization is a process. Application of crystallization is purification of salt that we get from the seawater, and next is separation of crystals of alum. Alum means fit curry from impure samples. So these are the two applications which were given in your book. Chromatography is also given in your book, and that is the separation technique, separation of mixture. The mixture is dissolved in a fluid called mobile phase, which carries it through a structure holding another material called stationary phase. Various constituents of the mixture travel at different speed, causing them to separate. In this way, the different substances get separated. So chromatography applications are to separate colors in a dye, to separate drug from the blood, and to separate pigment from the natural colors. One question is given, that is how you will separate a mixture containing kerosene and petrol which are miscible. So we can separate a mixture containing kerosene and petrol by distillation technique, since difference in the boiling point is more. So through distillation we can get them separated. Next question is, name the technique to separate butter from curd, salt from seawater, and camphor from salt. As we discussed these questions earlier, still answer is given that centrifugation method is used to separate butter from the curd, and evaporation method from salt and seawater, and sublimation process is used to separate camphor from the salt. Question is, what type of mixture are separated by the technique crystallization? From impure sample of solids, pure solid crystals can be obtained by the method of crystallization. For example, to obtain pure sugar from impure sample of the same. In this slide, we have to classify the following as chemical and physical changes. We have to keep in mind that physical changes where no new substance is formed and chemical where new substances is formed, like cutting of trees, chemical change. So let us discuss why cutting of trees is a chemical change. Since all chemical reactions stop and we cannot get back the original tree from the wooden pieces, so this is chemical changes. Melting of butter in a pan is a physical change, since there is no change in the chemical composition of the butter, only physical state changes from solid to the liquid. So this slide is very interesting. I hope you will enjoy it. Substances can be classified either as elements or compounds. Elements is a form of matter that cannot be broken down by the physical reaction into smaller substances. And compound is a substance composed of two or more different type of elements chemically combined in a fixed proportion. So that was the difference among the element and the compound. So element can be divided normally into metal, non-metal and metalloids. Metal usually show some of the following properties. You can stop the video and you can read it easily, that it is lustrous, have shining property and have a silver gray or golden yellow color, conduct heat and electricity, so good conductor of heat and electricity. These are ductile, can be drawn into wires, and malleable, can be hammered into thin sheets. These are called malleable. So these are also sonorous, means they will make sound when hit with something. An example of the metal are gold, silver, copper, iron, sodium, potassium, etc. Mercury is the only metal that is liquid at room temperature. Non-metal show some or all of the following properties. They display variety of colors, they are poor conductor of heat and electricity, they are not lustrous, sonorous, malleable, means they don't shine, they do not produce sound, they are can't be converted into sheets. Examples of non-metals are hydrogen, oxygen, iodine, carbon, bromine, chlorine, etc. So some elements have intermediate properties between those of metal and non-metal. They are called metalloids. So remember, what are metalloids? Those which have intermediate properties between metal and non-metal. Examples are boron, silicon, germanium, etc. Number of elements known at present are more than 100. 92 elements are naturally occurring and rest are man-made. Majority of the elements are solid. Even elements are in gaseous state at room temperature. Two elements are liquid at room temperature, that is mercury and bromine. Elements gallium and cesium become liquid at a temperature slightly above room temperature. So these were the facts regarding elements. Compound is a substance composed of two or more elements chemically combined in a fixed proportion. So now we will discuss about the mixture and the compound. Mixture is element or compound just mixed together to form mixture and no new compound is formed. So in case of compound, new compound is formed and that will have a fixed composition. So in case of mixture, composition is variable and it can be separated by any physical method. Mixtures show the properties of constituent substances. In case of compound, new substance has totally different properties. The constituent can be separated only by chemical or electrochemical reactions. This slide shows the matter. Matter can be solid, liquid or gas, and it can divide it into pure substance and mixture. We already discussed the mixture properties, that it can be homogeneous or heterogeneous. Homogeneous have uniform composition or heterogeneous have non-uniform composition. Mixture, for example, sugar in water, salt in water, and heterogeneous example hai sand and salt. Pure substances are elements and compounds. Elements can be broken down into elements cannot be broken down into simpler substances. Example is copper, oxygen, iron. Compounds are fixed composition, can be broken down into elements by chemical or electrochemical reactions. For example, water, methane, sugar, etc. So this slide is very easy. You can pause the video and study it again. You will understand. Enjoy learning, study hard so that you can achieve your goals. Thank you for watching Science in Simple Steps.